Ready for the word tonight? All right, get your Bibles. Come on. Get them in your hands. Stand to your feet. I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord together in prayer tonight. Oh, Father, it's so good to be in your house. Good to be in your presence tonight, Lord. As we approach your word tonight, God, we pray that you open it up to us and open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Lord, we thank you that tonight this is not about the wisdom of man. We didn't come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, tonight we came to hear from you. So welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we thank you for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet. God, there are brothers and sisters, Lord, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else. We see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we would ask that you bless all of our brothers and sisters, bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapel and Harvest, God, for The Way and Ecclesia, Trinity, Emmanuel Baptist, God, all the great churches that are out there for Victory and the Assemblies, God, and the Four Square denominations, Lord. We thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord. The Sabbatarians that meet on the Sabbath day, God, that are lifting up the name of Jesus, Lord. If they're preaching your gospel, your truth, God, we bless them as you would bless us. God, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters. Lord, scattered abroad throughout the world, we would ask that you cover them, that you protect them, Lord God. Deliver them, Lord, from the hand of their enemies and from the threats that have been breathed out against them, God. We thank you, Lord, that they endure to the end and that the name of Jesus be preached all over the world to your glory and to your honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement and we say, amen. Well, tonight, if you want to get your Bibles out and go with me to 1 Peter chapter 5, we're going to launch out from there tonight as we go. And I have a simple little message. God gave this to me a long time ago. And I believe that is really pertinent to where we're at tonight. You know, it's the start of a new year. And with the new year, oftentimes comes new goals, new vision, new dreams, those sorts of things. But as well, we've just gotten through the hump of the holidays. You know what I mean by that? Where it's almost like, you know, you're kind of just pressing through at the end of last year, right? At the end of the year, you're getting all the gifts. You're making sure you got all the arrangements. You've got the dinners and the family gatherings, all that kind of stuff. And then in January, it's almost like you have that big letdown, you know, and you just kind of, you take a deep breath. And then you get back into life. And there's almost that little pause that takes place during this time. And little by little, something creeps in called stress. And tonight I want to minister a little subject called how to deal with stress. Now, I would venture to say that each and every one of us in this place deals with stress, if not on a daily basis, at least on a weekly basis, especially in adults. Now, if we don't handle stress, stress will handle us. Come on, somebody. Anybody ever been handled by stress, right? You started to feel the toll, maybe you started getting headaches. You know, some people have had other health issues that have sprung forth from stress. And medically, they study stress. In fact, they've stressed out animals to see if they can produce the same results. And guess what? They had lab rats with ulcers. And they had monkeys that were all stressed out. Okay? And so if we don't handle stress, if that's what it does to animals, how much more for us? You know what I mean? Because we carry things, we carry weights, we carry pressures all the time. There are cares and things that we deal with on a daily basis. So we can either stress out or we can, you got to look at this, we can out-stress. You see what I'm saying? Now, I thought it was interesting. I was trying to define what stress really was. And in 1951, a British medical journal said stress, in addition to being itself, was also the cause of itself and the result of itself. Isn't that interesting? The man who coined the term stress, his name was Hans Selye, I think that's how you say it. He said, everyone knows what stress is, but nobody really knows. And I think all of us could identify with that. Everybody knows what stress is. When I say stress, you almost felt the weight come on you. You know what I'm saying? When I said how to manage stress, some of you guys said, oh, hallelujah, because I've got some of that I need to deal with. And each and every one of us, we could say that we have stress factors in our lives. There are things that when we start to think about them, when we start to talk about them, when we start to encounter them, the stress, the pressure comes on our lives. Now, according to research from the American Psychological Association, the APA, the top four causes of stress, are you ready for this? And see if one of these four stresses you out. First one is this. Can you guess it? Money. That's what it is. Number one stress factor in our lives is money. I don't know how I'm going to make it. I don't know what I'm going to do. I need to provide. I want to make sure to have a good life. And money stresses us out. Number two, right behind that, related to that, is work, your job. That's the number two stress factor. Number three is family. And number four is health. Those are the four stress factors that we have to deal with. Now, there are many other stresses that can come into our lives, especially in different seasons of life. The youth deal with peer pressure and stresses that go on there. Adults deal with different things. In fact, if you take a look at the studies that they've done on stress, would you think that men are more stressed or women? You're right, women. Women are more stressed out than men, okay? And then how about this one? We all could say this. Parents are more stressed out than people with no children. Okay, so mama, you got a big job ahead of you, and we're praying for you, but tonight we're going to give you some practical tools and some things about how to deal with those stresses in your life. Now, some of the signs of stress could be any number of things. Maybe you can see some of these things in your life and say, yeah, you know what, I'm dealing with that. But the signs are these: irritability. When you're stressed, you can be more irritable. Maybe you blow up on somebody because the stress, it wasn't the fact that somebody came and did something, you know, it was just a little pinprick that popped the balloon, right? And you can get really irritable. How about this? Lack of motivation. Sometimes when things stress us out, I just don't want to do it. I don't want to deal with it anymore. I just got to stop. I just need to just, you know, I don't even want to go there any longer. Fatigue. Stress can make you feel tired. Stress can make you feel like you just have no motivation, or like you're wore out, you're exhausted, or you're overwhelmed. Now, partner that, okay, you're tired, with this: sleeplessness. You're tired, but you can't sleep because you're up all night worrying about it. And it just adds to the stresses in your lives. How about this one? Nervousness, anxiety. Sometimes people can suffer from panic attacks because they start to get stressed out in their lives and they start to get nervous and then they start to freak out. Why? Because stress is on their lives. Stress can cause mental and health issues. Sometimes we take things on and it just gets on our mind, but also it can cause health issues. Most people handle stress. Now, this was very interesting to me. You know how most people, they polled people all over the United States and they asked them, how do you handle stress? When stress comes into your life, what do you do? The number one way that people handle stress is they watch television for over 2 hours in a row. I'm the type of guy that I start to think about things like that. Sometimes people are stressed out that they don't have enough time. And so because they're stressed out that they don't have enough time to do what they need to do, they will spend time watching hours of television being unproductive. If you need one extra hour of every day, just cut out an extra hour of television. You've got your hour right there, right? If you need 2 extra hours, maybe you could wake up 1 hour earlier and cut out 1 hour of television. Right there, you've added 10 full hours to your week. You've added a whole day to your work week. Pretty amazing. Most people watch television. Some people do this. They surf the internet or play video games. Very likely that, and also men, we're playing video games, that sort of a thing. Some people go to sleep. They don't want to deal with stress, so they just, I'm going to go take a nap. I'm just done. I'm going to lay down. Overeating. No one in here, but some people out there, when they get stressed out, they just, things are going in the mouth. I just got to have something. I just got to eat. And with that comes drinking alcohol and smoking cigarettes. People get stressed out. They just have to do something. They get that nervousness, and so it relaxes them. It relaxes me when I eat. It relaxes me when I drink. It relaxes me when I smoke a cigarette. See, we're dealing with stress all the wrong ways. Dealing with things the way that the world deals with things, rather than dealing with things the way God would have us to deal with things. And tonight I want to share with you, like I said, some practical things. Now, when I say practical things, I'm not talking about diet, exercise, sleep habits, all that kind of stuff. I'm talking about practical things from the Word of God, because if I can't find it in here, I can't believe God for it. I said, if I can't find it in here, then I can't believe God for it. But when I find the answers in the Word of God, now I can go to the throne room because I've got a promise, and I can say, Father, listen, I'm having a hard time in life. I'm dealing with stress, but I see this in your Word, and therefore, God, I'm going to believe you for it. Anybody with me tonight? So tonight, how to handle stress so that stress doesn't handle you. A couple of quick things, how to deal with stress. First one is this, and I had you turn to 1 Peter chapter 5 for this reason, is cast your cares on God. Just simply cast your cares on God. You don't have to carry the weight and the pressures of life on your own. You can cast your cares on God. Sometimes we get caught up, we're looking at the problem seems so big to us, and so we get stressed out about it. But if you would just cast that cares on God and look to God who's bigger than your problems, you would realize your problem's not that big. Now, I've heard this quote attributed to Ian McLaren as well as to Corrie Ten Boom, but it's a great quote no matter who said it. But they said that worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow, but it does empty today of its strength. See, when we get stressed out and when we worry about things and we allow things to weigh us down, it doesn't deal with the issue. But what it does do is it incapacitates us. It hinders us. It holds us down. And it robs us of our joy, of our strength, of our productivity. And yet, if we can just cast that care on the Lord, then we don't have to carry it any longer. 1 Peter chapter 5, starting in verse number 5. I'm going to start in the middle of the verse, so little letter B, if you will. There's a quote. Some of your Bibles have it all by itself. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5, look at what it says. It says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Very important that we understand some things. First of all, what is grace? If God's given grace to the humble, okay, and we know that God is good, and that God's given us something that we need, then what does grace mean? Well, grace is simply God's sovereign divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. That's grace. Grace is God's empowerment. It's his ability on my behalf. I couldn't do it. I can't handle life. I can't handle the weight of the finances. I'm not smart enough. You know, I'm not really a great enough leader to lead other people on the job or at home. You know, we have all these pressures and all these things. I hope that I'm raising my kids right. I hope that, you know what, I can just contribute somewhere. I want to live a life that's bigger than myself. And because of these things, we get stress on our lives. Now, stress is not all bad, okay? Let me make sure that we define this. Stress is not all bad. Stress can be a motivating factor. In fact, if we didn't have pressures on us, some of us wouldn't do anything. Right? Why change if there's no pressure to change? Why do something if there's no motivating factor? And sometimes pain or pressure can motivate us. But there's a bell curve. You know what a bell curve is? It goes up like this. And then it goes down on the other side like a bell, right? Okay, now that bell curve, if you were to go up the stress level of the one side, that stress level, as stress increases, it's actually good. You start being productive. You start doing good. But then there's a hump that you come over that's your fatigue level, the amount of pressure that you can handle. And when you cross over that, your productivity stops and you start to plummet down into problems, pressures. Now you start to plummet down into those mental and physical issues that come along. You start to plummet down into lack of productivity and drive and motivation, all those things that we talked about. So in order for us to understand this, okay, so God resists the proud, right? So stress can motivate us. And we can say, I got this. There's pressure on me. I can do this. But then sometimes we get to that top of that bell curve and all of a sudden we're out of our league. Now, me being a man, I can speak for the men. Sometimes us men can be pretty hard-headed. I got this. God, you just hang tight, Lord. Right? We can even make it spiritual. God made me a man. Men are strong. Men are focused. Women are the ones that are stressed out. I heard that from Pastor Dan. That was a statistic. Somebody researched that. It's smarter than we are. And they said it was true. Pastor Dan probably found it on the internet. It must be true, right? I can handle this. And so we, in our pride, say, I got this, and end up going nowhere. Why? Because God resists the proud. God says, you're going to be proud. You're going to sit there and see if you can do it yourself. Let's see. And nothing gets done. But he gives grace. He gives ability. God's ability, not man's ability. Listen, I don't want man's ability. I want the God ability, right? I don't want the natural. I want the supernatural ability of God on my life. So if God resists the proud, then first things first, I need to admit, I can't do this. I'm out of my league, God. I'm in over my head, Lord. Help. Jesus, take the wheel. I need you to just come and take over right now. And see, at that point, then it says God gives grace to the humble. Look at the next verse, verse 6. Therefore, because of what I just said about God, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in due time. In other words, God, you've got this. Your timing is right on point, God. You've got this. I trust you, Lord. Now look at this. The verse is not done yet. Verse number 7 comes along. There's not a period. There's a comma. And look at what it says. Casting your care upon him, for he cares for you. Maybe tonight this is a word for somebody in this place. You came in here and you thought that nobody in the world cared about you. I'm here to tell you tonight that God cares deeply about your life. He loves you. And someone may be saying, you know, I just am so stressed. I'm under so much pressure. I just want to end it all. Listen, you do not have to end it all. This is a new beginning for you tonight because God cares about you, and you don't have to carry that stress. You don't have to carry that weight. You don't have to carry that pressure any longer. You don't have to throw in the towel. God's in your corner. He's on your side. God loves you, and he cares about you. And if you will cast your care on him, he'll take it. He'll take that weight. He'll take that pressure. He'll take that stress off of your lives. See, you can give the problems to the Lord. See, sometimes just praying about the situation is all you need to do. You know that? You ever had that experience where you went into your prayer closet and you said, God, I'm stressed. God, I've got pressure. I've got weight on my life. And you casted your care on him. Afterwards, you feel better, right? Now, listen. Most likely, the situation didn't change. But what changed? We changed, right? The pressure on us changed. Now you can handle it. Why? Because it's out of your hands and it's in God's hands. See, sometimes all you need to do is just cast your care on the Lord and the stress is gone like that. And you say, Pastor, what do I do if the stress is still there? Second thing for tonight. Here we go. You ready? Stay in the peace of God. Not only cast your care on the Lord because he cares for you, but secondly, you have to stay in the peace of God. Why? Because we can get out of our prayer closet, and when the problem, that stress factor in our life, or how about this, when the person, you know who I'm talking about, right? That, we'll call them that stress factor. Maybe the stress factor is your husband. Maybe the stress factor is your wife. Men, do not say amen right now. I'm helping you. Maybe the stress factor in your life is your boss. Maybe the stress factor in your life is your children. Maybe the stress factor in your life is your bank statement. Whatever it is, when you go back out of your prayer closet and it's staring you in the face, you have to stay. Everybody say stay. You have to stay in the peace of God. See, because by faith you receive that peace. When you cast your care, the weight's off of you. But if you walk out of the room and you pick it right back up, you've got issues. You've got problems. And now stress is going to be handling you instead of you handling stress. Isaiah chapter 26. Turn there with me. Isaiah chapter number 26. Great verse. Great verse to remember. Great verse to come back to. Isaiah chapter 26. Take a look at this in verse number 3. Isaiah 26, 3 says, you will keep him in perfect peace. Does anybody in this place want perfect peace? I know I do. I'm right there with you. You will keep him in perfect peace. Now that word him, maybe some of your Bibles have the word him in little italics. You know why that is? Because that word wasn't originally there. Okay? So you will keep in perfect peace. Okay? So you could insert your name right there. God, you will keep Dan Roth in perfect peace. You will keep, how about this two-letter word, me, in perfect peace. How does God do that? How does God keep us in perfect peace? Because when I live my life, when I go to the job, when I go home after work, when I go down to the city, whatever I'm doing, I'm not always in perfect peace. So how does this work? Look at the next part of the verse. Whose mind is stayed on you. Uh-oh. See, it has a lot to do with what's going on up here. Is your mind staying on Jesus? On the power of the Lord? On the grace of God? Or is your mind staying on the problem? See, the more you dwell on the problem, what you look at the longest becomes the strongest in your life. And so if you're staring at the bills, if you're staring at the problem, if you're staring at the situation, if you're staring at the breach of relationship, if you're looking at the wrong things, then you're going to get the wrong response. You're going to get that stress on you. But if your mind is stayed on God, and if when the problem shows up, you say, hey, I may be lacking here, but God isn't lacking. I may not have the answers here, but God has the answers. I may not have the wisdom to do this, but God is the one who gives me wisdom. See, if your mind is stayed on him, then you will have perfect peace. Why? Because I cast my care, and God's got this, and now I can stay in his peace. Look at this. Whose mind is stayed on you? Because he trusts in you. See, you may not trust your boss. You may not trust your husband or your wife or your kids or your neighbors. You may not trust the economy or the politicians. And that's okay. As long as your trust is in the right spot, if your trust is in God, and if your mind is stayed on him, then you will have perfect peace. Can you say amen? Just ask yourself this question when stress factors come into your life. Is my mind going to the problem or is it going to God? Where's my mind going? There's a story of a time when Napoleon's army was marching through Austria, and they came to a small village. And this little village had no army. The Austrian army had not come there. They did not know that this army was marching through. And as Napoleon's army came in, they were looking at it saying, we're defenseless. They're just going to come in and capture us. We have no way of defending ourselves. Now, it happened to be Easter Sunday. And so that morning, they got up and they said, what do we do? Do we go and surrender ourselves or do we have church right now? And they said, well, you know what? I believe that God would want us to have church. So they opened up the church doors, they rang the church bells, and they had church that morning, and they had a wonderful time that morning. And then they went out and they were expecting the army to be there. But the army was gone. You want to know why? Because the army was a distance away, and they heard the church bells ringing, and they thought to themselves, why would they be ringing the church bells? The Austrian army must have come. We better get out of here. And they left that little town alone. See, if you can keep your mind on the things of God and put God as the priority, then God will keep you safe from the stresses that the enemy would try and put on you. Oh, my goodness. See, it's all about where our mind goes. Is your mind stayed on the Lord, or is your mind stayed on the problem? Look at what Jesus said, John chapter 14. Turn there with me. It's good for us to get these verses in our Bibles. John chapter number 14. Verse number 27, if you have the red letter edition, you'll notice these are the words of Jesus in red. John chapter 14, verse 27, Jesus says this, says, peace. Everybody say peace. That's what we're talking about. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Remember, perfect peace. That's a perfect peace. Don't you think so? Jesus was perfect. Jesus is God. So if Jesus has given us his peace, that's perfect peace. Look at what he says. I give to you not as the world gives, do I give to you. Now look at this next little three-letter word, let. You know what let means? It's your choice. You can either choose to do this or you can choose not to do this. You can either look at what God's doing, or you can look at the problem. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. See, we have a choice each and every day to either stay in the peace of God or to look at the problems, look at the stresses, and allow those things to stress us out and deal with us. Which brings us to the last one, okay? Not only should we cast our cares on the Lord because he cares for us, not only should we stay in the peace of God, but finally for tonight is this, is walk in the Spirit. We got to walk in the Spirit. See, this is not a natural fight. And even though I mentioned exercise, diet, you know, all those things, sleep patterns, and that stuff can help. Okay, I'm not diminishing that in the natural. All that stuff can help manage stress. But that's not going to deal with the problem. This is not a natural battle. Your husband, your wife, your boss, your children, the neighbors are not your enemy. The devil is your enemy. And he fights dirty. And those pressures, some of them we take on ourselves. I know I've done that. Man, worried about stuff that I had no business worrying about. And yet, there are other things that the devil adds. Thoughts, hints, little things coming in. What did they mean by that? Why would they say that to me? They know what I've been through. See, these little stresses, these little pressures, little thing, and then there's a spiritual attack that comes against us. And so we're casting our care, and we're staying in the peace of God, and we still have stress factors coming in our lives. Why? Because it's a spiritual battle, and we need to walk in the Spirit. This morning, my wife and I were having some intense fellowship. You know what that is? We're having a fight. Right? Stressed out. Arguing. The kids later shared, we've said we love you and we forgive you and made up and all that kind of stuff. So it's okay, Pastor Dan and Jess are just fine, all right? So you can pray for us, but you don't have to pray for us, you know what I mean? So anyways, but the kids were talking to my wife today and they said, Mommy, you know, in the past, when you guys have been fighting, you know, there was one time you guys were fighting for a long time. And our daughter Chloe, she's like little pastor, you know, she's little miss. I just tell you, someday she's going to be pastoring us, if not already, I think. But anyways, she said there was one time that we were fighting, and so she went up, she just laid her hand on the wall of our bedroom where we were fighting. She was on the other side, laid her hands, and she said, God, I pray that they just make up, that they forgive each other, and that they come out and they ask forgiveness from us. Within a couple of minutes, we had ended the fight, walked out of the room, said, kids, forgive us for fighting. See? Sometimes we think, well, what could a kid do? They're just young. They don't know anything yet. But yet, here's a little girl that didn't fight it in the natural. She fought it in the spiritual and got spiritual results. Supernatural results. And sometimes we think, well, what could I do? I'm just the low guy on the totem pole. I'm just the peon. And I got a lot of pee on me, right? Because people have been just going crazy on me. You know, the boss is down my neck. I don't know what to do. I don't know how I'm going to make it. And we think, well, what can I do? I'm not rich. I'm not wealthy. I'm not influential. I'm not famous. I'm not powerful. I didn't win the Powerball. Okay, I know who went and bought those tickets, all right? You were going to pay off the church. I understand. I understand. It's all good. It's all good. Okay. We'll do it another way, by the grace of God. But see, we think, what can I do? I mean, it's just me. And yet, we are spiritual giants on the inside that are asleep because we don't know the strength that we have. If we would just walk in the Spirit and not wage war according to the flesh, if we would remember, this is not a natural battle that I'm fighting right now, but I'm fighting a spiritual war. And if we would raise up with the weapons of our warfare, armed and ready for battle, and take our stand, we would see supernatural results. And rather than hit that fatigue level and that pressure and start to decline, that stress will cause us to rise to the throne. Why? Because we've humbled ourselves under the mighty hand of God. We cast our care on him, and now he is exalting us. He is lifting us up with his ability. We're staying in his peace, and we're walking in the Spirit. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, turn there quickly. 2 Corinthians chapter number 10. Great section of verses if you're fighting a spiritual fight. I just want to point out one verse, verse number 3. 2 Corinthians chapter number 10, verse number 3. Look at what it says. For it says, for though we walk means live out our life, even though we live this way. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. What is he saying? He's saying this is not a natural battle. If you're fighting it in the flesh, you're fighting a losing fight. But if you're fighting it in the spirit, you've already got the victory. It's just a matter of time before it manifests, before it appears right before your eyes. Galatians chapter 5, verse number 16, last verse for tonight. Galatians, turn there with me right after 2 Corinthians, you'll find the book of Galatians. And in Galatians chapter number 5, it says this, verse number 16. It says, I say then, walk, remember what walk means, live out your life. Though we live in the flesh, we don't war according to the flesh. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Have you ever just wanted to be negative? Okay, come on. It's okay to be honest in church, all right? Have you ever just wanted to just sit down and I'm just going to find my little Eeyore spot and I'm just, you know what, I'm having a bad day. Just leave me alone. Everybody shut up. Go away. Leave me here to watch 2+ hours of television. I'm going to binge watch, right? That seems to be a big thing in our nation right now. We're going to binge watch something, right? Why? Because we want to be negative. I want to pull the covers over my head and let the dark cloud of despair just cover me. We've got these negative attitudes. But yet, that's what the flesh wants to do. And if that's what you're feeling like, I feel like I want to go back into depression. I feel like I want to be negative. I feel like just being nasty. I just got a case of the nasties this morning. Anybody ever had a case of the nasties in the morning? You woke up and you didn't even know why. You just wanted to be mean and rude and alienate everybody that you care about, right? I've had those days. And yet, that's what the flesh wants to do. That's what this earth suit wants to do. But that's not what the Spirit wants to do. If you would walk in the Spirit, you wouldn't fulfill the lust of the flesh. When you're walking in the Spirit, when you're casting your cares, when you're staying in the peace of God, and when you're staying after it, fighting a spiritual fight, then you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That case of the nasties will be cured immediately. Hallelujah, amen. God is good. Thank you for that weak response. We've got to stir ourselves, church. Oswald Chambers said this. He said, all our fret and worry is caused by calculating without God. All of our fret and worries are caused by calculating without God. See, when your mind is going, if your mind links up with the flesh, you're in for trouble. But when the mind links up with the Spirit, now you've put the God factor in there. Hey, I can't make it, but God. This relationship is done, but God. The marriage is over, but God. They're going to fire me, but God. Right? The world is going to hell in a handbasket, but God. All the politicians, but God. Stress, but God. See, we got to walk in the Spirit. Keep your mind on the things of God. See, oftentimes we think that if I could just vent, if I can just run this off, if I can just give it time, if I can just sleep it off. But that's not going to make it. We have to stay in the Spirit. Here's what we learned tonight. Cast your cares, stay in peace, and walk in the Spirit. If you want to deal with stress, it's that simple. Cast your cares, stay in peace, and walk in the Spirit. Say it with me. Cast your cares, stay in peace, and walk in the Spirit. One more time. Cast your cares, stay in peace, and walk in the Spirit. Can you say amen to that tonight? Hallelujah. Let's do this. Everybody stand to your feet. Everybody stand up. Let's have a little exercise doing this, okay? Everybody get your stress right here in your hand and clench it tight because that stress, sometimes that stress is like a ball in your stomach, right? That stress is just worrisome. That stress is just, it hurts, right? So clench that fist tight. Get your stress. Okay, some of your stress looks like someone. Get them. Right now. Get and squeeze them. Make them pay. You got it? Got it? Okay, I want you to, don't hit your neighbor, all right? But just lean back real quick, okay? Tell your neighbor, give me some elbow room. I'm going to toss this really far right now, okay? So I need some space. If you got to spread out a little bit, okay, do what you got to do. All right, now make this declaration right now. Say, Lord, this is my care that I cast to you in Jesus' name. My mind won't be on the care. It'll be on you. I'm staying in your peace. And I'm not walking in the flesh any longer. I'm walking in the Spirit in Jesus' name. Now cast that care. Come on, get it. Cast it. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Woo! God is good. God is good. Hallelujah. Hey, take a seat real quick. I just want to take a couple moments before anybody takes off. I want to make sure that your heart is right with God and that before you leave this place, that we make sure that the most important thing in your life is taken care of. See, oftentimes we take on the stresses and the pressures of bills and family and all those things, and we don't pay any attention to what's most important, and that's our eternity. I just want to take 15 minutes of your time that could change your eternal life. So will you give me a couple more minutes of your attention? And then I'll let you go. Tonight, I want to ask you a couple questions. First one is this. What if tonight was your last night on the earth and you died? Where would you go? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? And sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. You know, I think it's kind of rude and I'm a little bit offended that you talked about it. You know, God's a loving God and I don't think a loving God would send people to hell. Well, he loves us so much that he gave us a free will choice while we're here on the earth. He doesn't want a bunch of robots to bow down and worship him. If he wanted that, he could have created trillions of them. Innumerable robots that just all they did was bow down and worship God. God doesn't want a robot. He wants someone who actually loves him from their heart, of their own choice and their own will. And so we have a choice while we're here on the earth, whether or not we're going to go to heaven or whether or not we're going to choose hell. Now, hell is a very real place. You'll find it in the Bible. God talks about it. Old and New Testament, Jesus talked about it. Very real place. And you're not going to avoid hell just by saying you don't believe it's real. It doesn't make it go away. It's like burying your head in the sand and expecting not to get touched by the wind. It doesn't work. Tonight I want to talk about your eternal life. Let's make sure that everyone in this place ends up in heaven with God forever and ever. Now remember I said a couple questions. First question is, where do you think you'd end up? I don't think anybody was saying, well, I think I would end up in hell. If that's the case, we'll take care of that tonight. Most of you in this place, though, said, well, I think I'm going to go to heaven. I really hope I'd go to heaven. Maybe I'd go to heaven. I really don't know. But listen, you cannot think, hope, or maybe your way into the kingdom of God. You got to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. So here's the next question is, what makes you think you're going to heaven? You know, sometimes people think that if I can just be good enough, God lets good people into heaven. But did you know that nowhere? Check it out. Nowhere in the Bible does it say we can be good enough to get to heaven. In fact, the Bible records that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. No one's going to make it to heaven based on their own goodness. Because our goodness compared to God's goodness, the Bible says, is like filthy rags, going to get thrown out, not going to get to stay. So you can't be good enough to get to heaven. Sometimes people think, well, I'm going to make it to heaven because I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. Hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child. And you've always considered yourself to be a Christian. You were born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhists, Muslims, Hindus. We're Christians, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible, check it out, nowhere does it say that because your parents raised you in church, tell you you're a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Doesn't matter if they had you baptized or christened as a child, took you to religious classes like Sabbath school or Sunday school or catechism. Doesn't matter if they hung that cross or St. Christopher around your neck. It doesn't work like that. Nowhere in the Bible to say you're born in America, that your citizenship here in America just gets you automatic citizenship in heaven. It doesn't work. And again, nowhere, check it out, nowhere does it say that because you're not some other religion that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Come on, let's talk about your eternal life tonight. Some of you said, well, Pastor, okay, I get that, but not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church in front of you right now. And while that's great and I'm glad that you're here, do you know that nowhere in the Bible says just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian? It's like me saying, you know what, I'd really like to be a car. I love cars. You know, and I want to be a fast car. And so I ran to my garage, and I sat in the garage, and I said, I'm a car. Listen, I'm just a dude sitting in his garage with the wrong thinking. Some of you in this place think that just because you sit in a church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian, when nothing could be further from the truth. And tonight, let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, I think I'm going to go to heaven, not only because I sat in church, but you don't understand, Pastor. My last church, I was involved. I sang in the choir for a number of years, helped the pastor out, carried his Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader, taught in the Bible class. I even got a membership card I could show you. Doesn't that mean I'm a Christian? Well, you know that nowhere in the Bible is God waiting at the gates of heaven looking for your membership card to a church or for your volunteer hours sheet? God's not looking for us. Again, that brings us back to good works, doesn't it? Not going to make it. We can't be good enough, do enough, volunteer enough to get ourselves into heaven. You say, but Pastor, hold on a second. I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate Christmas and sing the songs every year of my life. Celebrate the resurrection at Easter time. I know God. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Yeah, that's great. But you know who else can quote scriptures? Is the devil. He's not a Christian. You know who else knows about Jesus? Is the demons. And yet they tremble. But that doesn't qualify them for heaven. Everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head that counts. Not about having mental assent towards God. Knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. Jesus was speaking to a man by the name of Nicodemus, who was a good guy, by the way, did a lot of good deeds, raised up in his church, did just a wonderful work. He was a teacher in Israel, taught people about God. We would have thought anybody knew about God and about heaven and hell and all this that we're talking about tonight. We would have thought it was this man, Nicodemus. And yet when Jesus is speaking to him, he doesn't just pat him on the back and say, Nick, man, hey, you got it going on. Just keep doing what you're doing and I'll see you in heaven. No, rather, what does he say? He says, you want to enter the kingdom of heaven? You must be born again. Now, hold on. Some of you turned off right there. You said, born again. Ugh. Saw it in a movie. That was on TV, wasn't it? I read about that on someone's blog, and I didn't really like that. That was weird. And I don't want to have any part of that. But listen, if you don't have any part of that, you will never enter the kingdom of God. But being born again isn't what television, movies, Hollywood, books, the internet, magazines tell us. Rather, it's what the Bible says about it. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus Christ. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit from my mouth. Now that's gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, well, what's that all about? It's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, I'm going to give you an opportunity. I want to offer you the opportunity to choose heaven and deny hell, to be born again. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, your call, your choice. You can sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right, or you can grab hold of this opportunity. Here's how it's going to work. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and then I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now, you might be thinking, whoa, wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. But let's get over that tonight, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. And yet the enemy, the devil, is trying to talk you out of this right now. Thinks you're dumb. Thinks you're stupid. And yet, listen, he's the dumb one. He's already defeated. You tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake, you're going on with God. You're smart. Tonight, all across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, if it's open, and you're sitting there, hey, get ready. And then tell an usher right afterwards or come back into the church service. If you're watching online on the live stream, wherever you're at, across the nation and around the world, God sees and God's watching, and you can lift your hand, right, in a moment when we do this together. And then minimize your browser, click the blue button that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and then find the tab that says how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. Who should raise their hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? Come on, I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place and you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it? Get ready to get your hand up. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three, four, five, six. Thank you. Who else tonight? Seven. Got you over there. Anybody else real quick? There's seven wise people already. Anybody else real quick? Seven up there. Is that one? All right. Seven. I got you right here in the middle. Eight. Thank you. God bless you. Over here on this side. Eight. Nine over there. Okay. Got you, my man. If I've already seen your hand, you can put it down. But if you say, oh, you know what, I haven't yet put my hand up, or Pastor, you haven't seen me yet, go ahead and get your hand up real high right now if that's you. Anybody else real quick? About seven or eight wise people. Anybody else real quick? I got you over there. Thank you. Thank you, number eight. God bless you. Anybody else? Number nine and ten, you're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Go for it. You say, Pastor, you were just talking about stress, and now you're pressuring me. Listen, this is good pressure. And the devil's on the other side saying, you don't have to do this. This is emotionalism. This is sensationalism. You don't need to do this. You're okay. You've done enough good. Listen, we talked about this. We overcame all that. Let the pressure of God be greater than the pressure. It's on the inside of you, or that's surrounding you. Come on, you know you need to do it. Number nine and number ten. Let's go for God tonight. Let this be good pressure that pushes you in the right direction. Anybody else? Come on. That's you. Just lift your hand up high. Just want to take another minute and allow you that opportunity. If you feel like your heart's about ready to pump out of your chest and you know that it's you, come on. Will you just do this? Just let gravity take over and let your hand fall up. All right? Anybody else real quick? Come on, let's go for God tonight if that's you. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, I wish I could make you do it, but I can't. You got to do it yourself. So, hey, let's rejoice over the eight or nine wise people, however many there were, gave God their heart and life tonight already, raising their hands. Now listen, you don't get saved just by raising your hand. You got to give God all your heart, got to give God all of your life. Tonight we want to change destinies with you. And so if that's you, you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, number nine and ten, all right? It's not over yet. You still have an opportunity. In a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap, give a shout for you. Elijah's going to lead us in a song. As you hear that song, that's your cue. Get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. And I want you to get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand. And if you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down to the front. Come on down. Come on down. They're coming. You can come too. Come on down from the family rooms if you need to bring your children. They'll remember this. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. Anybody else, if you need to come, you can come right now. Come on down. Come on down. They're still coming. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. We'll wait for you. We'll wait for you. Just come on down right now. Come on down. All right. Hey, you guys. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, all right? You came to give God all your heart, came to give God all of your life, all right? So that's something to be happy about, okay? Right over here to my right, your left, waving at you. This is Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? I'm about as weird as you're going to get tonight, okay? You already made it through me. He's cool, okay? He's going to do three things. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again, brand new on the inside, okay? You'll still look the same, smell the same, but guess what? Brand new on the inside, okay? Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to read about what to do next in your walk with God. It's easy reading. It's free. Take maybe a half hour if you read slow, all right? But it'll just get you what the next steps are in your walk with God. Now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next, okay? He'll give that to you absolutely free. And then finally, he's going to give you something else free. He'll give you a friend. Free friends. That's just what we do here at The Rock is we give away friends. We call them spiritual personal trainers. Heard of a physical trainer? The gym helps you get strong, helps you get buff, right? Okay, spiritual personal trainer will do that for you spiritually. So you don't go back to the old ways, serving the devil, all stressed out like we talked about tonight. But now you're going on with God, casting your cares, staying in his peace, walking in the spirit, okay? I didn't grow in my walk with God until I had a friend come alongside me, teach me some things out of the Bible, someone that I could ask some questions to and say, hey, what about this? You know, and they could describe that for me and show me the way that God would have me to live. Spiritual personal trainer is that friend for you, okay? It's easy, it's free, and you need to do it, okay? And then right after he does all that for you, he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. If you make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Woo! God is good.